Dear sir or madam, I would like to present you a new rigid motion compensation approach for interventional CRMCT. It operates direct on the projection data by using a consistency measure, and I want to show you first clinical results. In our study, we aim for CRMCTs of stroke patients, which are applied to detect brain bleedings. The critical constitution of those patients leads often to head movements. Together with the long acquisition times of the system, it results often in heavy motion artifacts, as you can see on the right. Consequently, the image can become unusual for the physician, and therefore a motion compensation is mandatory. For such a motion compensation, we can state following requirements. It is well known that time is brain. So one major demand is that the routine is fast. Particularly, we want to avoid repetitions of expensive forward and back projections. Furthermore, an efficient implementation on GPU hardware should be possible. Next, we want to keep it as simple as we can by assuming head motion as a rigid motion. Last but not least, the correction shall be robust. In other words, it should reliably reduce motion artifacts. More to the point, it must not lead to a decrease in image quality. Our approach to meet these demands is a consistency measure based on Granger's fundamental relation for cone beam geometry. The basic idea of this measure was already published from Debler et al. In 2013 in connection with the calibration of industry CT scanners. It works directly on the projection images and has no need for a reconstruction. The advantage of this measure, in contrast to other methods which use redundancy, is the large number of redundant values you can obtain. We are able to collect up to 12,000 redundant values for each pair of C-arm projections. So how does it work? While we want to find redundant information in our projection images, this information is given by a so-called intermediate function, which is basically a linear transformation of our projections. Here delta prime denotes the derivative of the Dirac delta function, and gi the i-th projection, where the vector m declares the direction of the rays. Due to the inner product in the delta function argument, only rays which are in a plane with the normal vector n contribute to the integral. The crunch point is, which comes from Granger's relation, that the intermediate function is directly connected with the 3D radon transform of the object. This is nothing but integrals over 2D planes through the object. If we assume a static object, its 3D radon transform should not change, since integrals over a function cannot change if the function does not change. And as a consequence, the intermediate function should be an invariant. Each intermediate function value belongs to such a 2D radon plane with a normal vector n, and it can be calculated from the projection values along the blue dashed lines, which stand for the intersection lines with the flat panel detectors. In order to determine which intermediate function values of two different projections should be equal, we have to find redundant radon planes, which are usable for a comparison. Such a plane has only two constraints. It has to contain the source positions, and naturally, it has to intersect with the detector areas. Subsequently, we can quantify the accordance of the two intermediate function values for each plane. For this purpose, we propose a normalized p-norm metric, where we have a tuning parameter p. Then we can summarize over all other projections to quantify the consistency with respect to all other projections. This is denoted with the capital EI. I won't go into full detail here, but to give you an impression how to obtain the intermediate function in practice, you can see in the formula on the right that you basically have to calculate the 2D radon transform of the projection images, denoted with R. And afterwards you just have to differentiate it and do some weighting. We can do this as a pre-processing step by an appropriate sampling of the intermediate function. then the essential task is to gather the radon planes which fulfill the mentioned constraints. And from this, we can calculate the lookups to the intermediate function, whose values are finally approximated by interpolation. This can be done very fast and in parallel with GPU hardware. With a so-defined measure, we've got an objective function which is implicitly dependent from the geometry of the system. We can minimize this function by varying the rigid parameters of our object. Those are equal to the rotations and translations along the axis of the world coordinate system as highlighted in red. Here we have to neglect the table and of course other objects which are not rigid connected with the patient's head. For the optimization routine, we formalize these 6 degrees of freedom in a 6-dimensional parameter vector. Here the upper 3 components define the rotational axis, while its norm gives us the angle of rotation. The lower 3 components are a translation vector. Furthermore, it is reasonable to separate these geometric changes into 2 distinctive groups. We have so-called out-of-plane parameters, which are assigned to movements stepping out of the plane of rotation, and we have in-plane parameters, which are variations within the plane of rotation. In our study, we investigated the sensibility of the consistency measure in simulation experiments, and we could state a high sensibility for the out-of-plane parameters, whereas variations in the plane are more difficult to detect with a measure. However, as we will see in the results, it is also possible to estimate in-plane motion. Now we want to have a look on the optimization of the out-of-plane parameters. We apply a simple sequential scheme where we optimize angle by angle consecutively. You can see the consistency measure matrix, which stand for the consistency values for each combination of projections. Left before the optimization and on the right after the optimization. You can clearly appreciate that there are certain angle intervals with an increase of the consistency measure. After the optimization, a distinct decrease within the stripes is visible. It turns out that these are indeed the intervals where patient motion occurred. On this slide, I want to show you the procedure of optimization more detailed. The plot shows the summarized consistency measure EI of each single angle, which we obtain by summarizing over the columns or the rows of the previous matrix. The lower two images show the difference between the real measured projections and the reprojections of the reconstructed volume. On the left side, the volume was projected with the original geometry of the scanner, and on the right, the geometry after the motion compensation was used. Now I will start the video, which illustrates the optimization in real time. If you look closely, you can appreciate mismatches in the original geometry, especially during the peaks in the matrix. This mismatch is reduced for the corrected geometry on the right side. And at the end of the day, you can see an obvious correlation between the correction magnitude in green and the matrix before the optimization. Therefore, we are able to see already from the pattern of our measure where motion appeared during the scan. So let's have a look at the reconstruction results. This is a reconstruction of the dataset we have seen before in the optimization, but here without the motion compensation. And this is after the correction. Once again, the direct comparison, where you can see an obvious reduction of motion artifacts. Here you can see another patient with motion during the scan, reconstructed with the original geometry from the scanner. And here after the motion compensation. Here's a further patient, where you can see also radial streaks starting at the metal plate. Also blurring at the edges of the tissue is visible. And now the same slice after the correction. Here you can see another patient with motion artifacts in the reconstruction. And here we achieve also an improvement of image quality. Also only by optimizing the out-of-plane parameters. Finally, we have one patient where the optimization of the out-of-plane parameters was not sufficient. However, we could apply an in-plane optimization with some modifications in the optimization scheme. And here you can clearly see a nice improvement. This is a comparison of the original geometry left. In the middle, the reconstruction after an out-of-plane optimization, and finally on the right, the correction of the full 60-parameter vector, including the in-plane parameters. As a conclusion, we can state that we could achieve first promising results on clinical data. We could meet all requirements that we mentioned before. That means that we could use the rigid model for the head motion. We can do the optimization very fast in about 30 seconds for one data set, and we've got a robust improvement for the out-of-plane parameters. The in-plane optimization is not robust for all data sets when using the simple optimization approach with the angle-by-angle scheme. But we are currently working on a higher robustness for the in-plane optimization, by modifying the matrix and incorporating smoothness constraints and so on. Also, the influence of other image artifacts, for example beam hardening and truncation, will be subject of future work. Thank you very much for your attention.